Welcome to the University of Michigan Dentistry Podcast Series, promoting oral health care worldwide.
The proximal box portion of the Class II cavity preparation should be considered as simply an extension of a Class I. Therefore, before the development of the proximal box has begun, the Class I portion of the preparation should be completed. As an aid for the proper extension of the proximal box, pencil marks should be placed on the tooth surface to indicate the projected buccal and lingual extensions that will be accomplished with rotary instruments. The first step in preparing the proximal box is to utilize a number 56 Fisher burr. This burr will expose the dentoenamel junction and at the same time will thin the marginal ridge. An attempt is made to thin the marginal ridge as much as possible, approximately to 1/2 millimeter, without it fracturing. This thin wall of enamel acts as a protection to inadvertent damage to the adjacent tooth. The following diagrams will demonstrate the positioning and the proper stroking of the number 2 round burr. The number 2 round burr is placed on the exposed dentoenamel junction as indicated in the upper right diagram. Note that the burr is placed 1/4 on the dentin surface and 3/4 on enamel. Proper depth is usually achieved with 3 or 4 strokings of the burr directed toward the cervical. When the burr has finally penetrated 1/4 to 1/2 millimeter beyond the cutting surface of the burr, it is then withdrawn. With the handpiece running at high speed, the burr is receded into the established cervical extension of the initial penetration and contacting this area of the tooth structure without cutting cervically. The burr is moved in a buccal direction, approximately 1/2 a burr width at a time, and then withdrawn. This procedure is repeated 2 or 3 times until proper extension is accomplished. After completing the buccal extension, the number 2 burr is placed into the original point and depth of penetration. The identical movements used for the buccal extension are now followed until the desired lingual extension is completed. The diagrammatic example will now be demonstrated on the extracted tooth. The dentoenamel junction is identified and penetration of the burr 1/4 in dentin and 3/4 enamel is begun. As mentioned before in the diagrammatic example, 3 or 4 strokings of the burr toward the cervical usually results in the burr penetrating to 1/4 millimeter beyond its cutting area. To check the depth, the burr is withdrawn, the handpiece is stopped, and the burr placed into the prepared tooth. With the handpiece running at high speed, the burr is receded into the point of initial penetration to the established depth and contacting this tissue without cutting. The burr is moved in a buccal direction until the desired extension is reached. After completing the buccal extension, the burr is placed back into the original depth of penetration and the identical movements are carried out in a lingual direction until the desired extension is reached. The following diagrams will illustrate the use of a number 56 straight Fisher burr. Please remember that the end of a Fisher burr will cut tooth tissue. Therefore, as the burr reaches the established depth of penetration, the lightest of pressures cervically must be used. This burr will accomplish 2 things. First, it will smooth the cervical floor. Second, it will place the inverse taper on the proximal walls. The diagrammatic examples will now be demonstrated on the extracted tooth. The burr is placed into the prepared tooth, very lightly contacting the cervical floor, and as the burr is moved buccally, it is positioned so it will produce an inverse taper on this proximal wall. The lingual wall is prepared in the same manner. The marginal ridge is now thinned even more. Very often, as is demonstrated here, a piece of the thin marginal ridge will break away. This creates no problem. Note the hole in the marginal ridge. An enamel hatchet is used to accomplish 4 objectives in this cavity preparation. First, to extend the proximal walls. Second, to place the proper flare on the proximal walls. Third, to prepare the cavo surface margins of the proximal walls for acceptance of the restorative material, and fourth, to smooth the cervical floor. A gingival marginal trimmer is used to place the two bevels of this cavity preparation. First, the bevel of the cervical enamel. Note here how rough the enamel looks and is on this preparation. Secondly, the bevel of the pulpal axial line angle. In beveling the cervical enamel, care must be taken with the buccal and lingual corners of the proximal box. As the instrument is being carried across the cervical floor, it must not strike the cervical corners of the proximal box. If this happens, a sharp groove is cut into these corners, and it is difficult to properly condense amalgam into these areas. Therefore, as the beveling is started, the marginal trimmer should be started 1 or 2 millimeters on the proximal wall and brought down the proximal wall, past the corner, and out onto the cervical floor for 1 or 2 millimeters. Then the normal movement of the instrument pulling across the cervical floor is accomplished. Then the gingival marginal trimmer is used to bevel the pulpal axial line angle. A number 1/2 round burr is used to place round retention in the proximal walls. The burr is placed 1/2 its width into dentin, just inside the dentoenamel junction at the cervical floor, and is stroked occlusally to the height of the pulpal floor. This prepared cavity is now ready to receive the restorative material.
You've been listening to a presentation from the University of Michigan School of Dentistry, which is dedicated to supporting open learning and open educational resources. This recording is licensed under the Creative Commons. It may be reused and redistributed for nonprofit use. Please attribute materials to the University of Michigan School of Dentistry and redistribute under this same license. For more information on how this and other University of Michigan School of Dentistry recordings may be used, visit www.dent.umich.edu/license.